Hello, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Sean Ella and D. George, and this is another game review. I haven't done this in a really long time, but there's a game coming out that's quite close to my heart, and I thought, you know what, I'll bring it back out of the bag, because apparently people like my opinions. Some people, you know, those like 10 viewers. Love you guys. So, game we're going to talk about today is Dawn of War 3. And for those of you who don't know, the open beta came out this weekend. This is the weekend of the 21st, 22nd, 23rd, and 24th. The beta is available across all four days. And I got a code, and I got some chance time to play it. And, spoiler alert, this view isn't positive. This review is not positive. But we'll get into that. So, a little bit of history first. For those of you who don't know, Dawn of War 1 and Dawn of War 2, both successful games in their own category, both RTS games, but they took a very different spin on the way of RTSs work. Dawn of War 1 was very classic. It was, you have your workers, you have your units, and you are playing mass combat with faceless armies. You occasionally had a couple of commander units. I think with all of the expansions, each army had 3 commander units and a Titan-esque unit. For some armies, that was literally a Titan unit almost. For others, it was just a large vehicle. So for the Space Marines, it was a Land Raider. But for the Eldar, it was the Avatar of Kain. And for, you know, the Sister Battle, it was Saint Celestine, which was probably the most broken of them all. And that was fun, and it was a great game. The 4 expansions that came out for it, Winter Assault, Dark Crusade, and Soulstorm, were all great. Sorry, the game and 3 expansions were all great, fantastic, at one of my favourite games of all time, and probably my favourite RTS of all time, up there with Age of Empires 3. But Dawn of War 2 took a very different spin on it. It made a game very dedicated to the heroes of the 40k universe, and if you've ever played Warhammer in the tabletop, you know that the game is quite hero-centered. It is about sort of these big, powerful leaders, and you know, your Primarchs and your Chapter Masters and your Captains and your Lords, your Generals, your Avatars, and they aimed the entire game around these characters. And they made it so they had retinues that followed them, but they changed the very core mechanics of the game, and they made it very less of an RTS. It wasn't really an RTS anymore. It was some kind of strange RPG hybrid. It was sort of, it felt when you were playing it like a mix between Diablo and some kind of bad, weird RTS. And it wasn't a pleasant experience. And the vast majority of people I've talked to and the reviews online did not like Dawn of War 2. Dawn of War 2 was considered a low point in the series. Dawn of War 2 came out a very long time ago. And it's been a very long time since we've seen a Dawn of War. And then last year we saw the trailer for Dawn of War 3 and everybody got excited. And if you haven't seen the trailer, I would recommend going and watching it, because it is a cinematic masterpiece, a beautiful trailer, and everyone got excited and they went, yes, this is finally the coming. And everyone was praying, sort of going, we need this to be like Dawn of War 1, not Dawn of War 2. And it's sort of a hybrid. So let's go into it. You can see, if you're watching this video, some people just listen to the audio, but if you're watching the video, you can see some Dawn of War 3 gameplay. The game is very strange now. Basically what they did was they took the traditional RTS multiplayer style, and I should say this beta was just the multiplayer, the campaign I'll get to a little bit later, and they took the traditional RTS multiplayer style, they added MOBA elements, similar to that of League of Legends, of Dota, of Smite, and then made it more snowball-y than possibly any game I've ever seen in my life. I'll be fair to it. We'll look at the pros first. The pros are that it looks absolutely beautiful. The game is very, very pretty. They've got the art pitch perfect. No longer are these sort of blocky looking space marines we sort of had in Dawn of War 1. The graphics are very good. The models are really good. They look beautiful. The game is very pretty in the way it looks. And they've taken big steps with the graphical enhancements. It's very smooth. It's a very good game in terms of the way it looks. But it's the content that's the problem. going into the gameplay, it feels great to start with because you've got your base building back. You start with your headquarters and your build unit, a servitor, and that feels great. And you look at it and you go, yes, we're back. We're back in the game. And you can spawn units from your headquarters and from your buildings, your barrackses, your armories. Your armories give you upgrades. You've got in-the-field upgrades. But then the game gets weird. Now, requisition points are back from Dawn of War 1. Dawn of War 1, you had to send a unit to capture a requisition point. They put their standard in it and you gained control of it. And then you could build a listening post on it to gain more resources out of it. With this one, all you have to do is stand your guys next to it. That's a good improvement. I like that. I never liked the fact that they had to slam a flag into the ground and then worship it for a minute while they captured it. That was always a little bit silly in my eyes. And I'm glad that's changed. And then you get to add additional bonuses to it. So you've got to decide whether the point creates requisition, whether it creates power, whether it creates elite points. We'll get onto those later on as well. Elite points, possibly the worst part of this game. We'll work into that. And then you get to build a listening post on it. And the listening post is basically entirely for defense. I think it provides a very small bonus to what you get out of it. But it's almost entirely for defense. It's got a bigger gun. It's tougher. It's stronger. And it will mow down small forces that come close. And that's great. And that's cool. But in the map they give you, there are two requisition points that are very easy for you to achieve, to get. And there are three in the center that you're designed to fight over. Now, I've played three games so far, and I don't really intend to play any more. The first one, my opponents were playing orcs, and they ran at me really fast. They had several more units than I did, even at an early stage of the game. They took the early early mid posts and defended them so well that I couldn't take them back. I sent forces, I sent units, I sent heroes, and I couldn't take them back. And I lost because my opponent just had more resources than me. And I was like, well, maybe it's just a bad experience. So I played the second game, and the second game, it was Space Marines versus Space Marines. But my opponent, bless him, I don't think he quite understood the concept of what he was supposed to be doing. I took the early points quite fast. It took him a very long time to attempt to amass sort of any kind of counterattack. And after the first one failed, he sort of gave up. And I quickly took over all three of the extra points. And I snowballed to victory really, really easily. I upgraded all my points fully. It gave me a huge amount of resources. And I just built an army so big that he had no chance of ever stopping me. And then the third game really nailed it in the coffin for me. I was against a reasonably skilled opponent. And we both got off to a good start. We had a few skirmishes around these midpoints. I captured one on one side. He captured one on the other side. We sort of met in the middle. We started shooting each other. I put some snipers in a good position and he lost a lot of units. Then his snipers counter-sniped me and I lost all of them. It was a really good fight. And this is the video that you're watching right now. But unfortunately, it all sort of fell apart. And I lost my ground. He got a good hero unit in first. He got the Inquisition kill team. And my guys lost, so I pulled everybody back. And unfortunately, from there on, it was just a losing fight. There was almost no way I was going to win this. And you'll see it in the video that there's very little I can do. There's very little wiggle room. It's not like a game like StarCraft or Age of Empires where there's a lot of wiggle room in your strategy and what you can do. There's very little you can do. And I just lost, and I just got obliterated and walked over. It was a 30-minute game, but honestly, the game was over at 5, over at 6. As soon as you start to lose in this game, there is no comeback potential at all. And that makes it really snowbally. And for those of you who aren't really sure what the snowball term means, that's basically what it means. It means that you are not coming back from this and you're not going to live. It's very common in MOBAs, and the MOBA elements they added to this haven't really helped to that. What they have now is you have an energy core in your base, and you have between next in up, you have two turrets on either side of the map, and then two shield generators. And your opponents have to destroy the shield generators, then destroy the turrets, then destroy your core, and they win. Now, to me, that's an unnecessary mechanic. There's really no need for that. And rumor says that that's just one game mode, and there'll be other game modes. But it's clearly the primary game mode. And I've got a problem with that, because that's not Dawn of War. That's some crap they've made up that doesn't make any sense. There is no reason for it to be there lore-wise. There's, as far as I can see, no reason to be there gameplay-wise. It just adds an unnecessary step that there's no need for. And it just creates this really strange mechanic where you feel like you're playing League of Legends. And that's weird to me. And as soon as your opponent starts gaining ground, you lose all of your ground, because as soon as they destroy a shield generator or a turret, they gain a lot of requisition and a lot of power and a lot of points. I believe you get an elite point or two from each thing you destroy. And now the elite points I'll get onto now, because they are really the crux of this game, and they really nailed it in the coffin for me. In the game, each race has a set of heroes. Now, these heroes, for the Space Marines, for example, are a Terminator Captain, a Librarian, an Inquisition Kill Team, a squad of three Assault Terminators, and an Imperial Knight. Now, that's a fairly sort of stacked roster of units, right? Now, apparently there are going to be 15 per race going into the main game, but there are only 5 in the beta. And you look at those and you think, wow, some of those are pretty powerful units. If you ever played the tabletop, you'll know that, you know, Imperial Knights are insane. You'll know that Terminators are fairly strong units. Although I'm never lucky, so they're never strong for me. But you sort of look at these units and go, well, they're not going to change the game. The Imperial Knight might, but the Imperial Knight is the top of the chain, right? One single captain is not going to change the entire game, right? If you've got three squads of guys with guns, they're going to kill the captain fairly fast. Dawn of War doesn't have that. Dawn of War decided that a Terminator captain should be able to backflip into battle and slam his hammer and demolish several squads very, very quickly. Bad. Real bad. Basically, you gain elite points over time. I'm not quite sure what determines it. I don't know whether making actions determines it or not. But for example, on this map, the center point gives you more elite points. And if you put a generator on it, you generate more elite points faster. I don't know what other ways generate elite points faster. There is no mention of it in the tutorial. It says that there are elite points, and that you can put them on some requisition places. And that's it. It doesn't really go into detail. Now, these units are mind-boggling. They do some ridiculous shit. Gabriel Angelos, who is the Terminator captain I mentioned earlier, he is a fully Tartarus, I believe it's Tartarus pattern, Terminator-armoured captain carrying a demon hammer by the name of God Splitter. And that's cool. I like it. His model is lovely. His in-game model, anyway. I wish they did a tabletop model for him, but they haven't, so we'll wait for that. It's probably coming. And his abilities are that he can front flip into battle and slam his hammer into the ground, knocking everybody back, or he spins his hammer in a circle, knocks everybody back, and creates a shield around himself. And those abilities sound pretty good, and they are, because he also has a health bar about quintuple the size of a normal Space Marine squad, which is 5 dudes. For anybody who's played the tabletop, you know that Terminator armor is honestly not a huge step up from power armor. So that's a little bit over the top right there. But then you go a little bit further. And it's so snowball-y in the way that they really don't stack up with each other. So you have your Inquisition kill team at 2 elite points. And that's just a squad of dudes with guns. They have vortex grenades that stun people, but I don't think the stun works on heroes, so, eh. And I have had a squad of them completely wiped out by Angelos, who costs 4 elite points. Now, you think that makes sense. But then, I played against the Orcs, and the Orc Weird Boy, who is a Psyker, cost 3 or 4, I think. Probably, I think 3. 3 elite points. And Gabriel Angelos cost 4. And this weird boy utterly, utterly eviscerated Angelos and about 3 squads of tactical marines in my first game. I wish I'd been recording, because I sat there looking at my screen like I have no idea what's going on. This weird boy turned up, put a boulder into several of my squads. They just ceased to exist. Angelos was about half health, and then like a squad of boys got him in combat while the weird boy shot him. And that was it. And I'm sat there sort of looking at it going, oh, look at all this hard work I just put into my battle that just got wiped away. And then they took a requisition point And all of a sudden, I can't win that, but I'm losing resources. I'm rambling a little bit, but it's disappointing that they have created a mechanic that is so snowball-y that the games aren't enjoyable. Now, I don't care if I win or lose in RTS. I play with my friends a lot. I could play against my friends several times. I don't really care if I win or lose because I'm all about just base building and killing each other. But when the game you're playing is to the point where there is no chance of you coming back. You can watch the gameplay that's in front of you. By this point, I'm dead. I've already lost the game. And when there is no chance of you coming back and no chance of you being able to recover, the game isn't fun. Now, maybe it's because I'm not used to the game. Maybe, actually, there is a lot of comeback potential and it's all about matchups. And say, you should just be hoarding resources into las cannons when a hero comes. But it doesn't tell you that. And the las cannon teams are only 3 dudes. And it costs a lot of requisition. And if you've got an enemy hero barreling down your shield generators, you're not getting requisition very fast. And it feels like to me that this isn't a fair game. And I understand RTS is a snowball-y. But it should be down to your ability to control that and to go, right, my opponent is snowballing away. He's getting more requisition than me. I need to say this is StarCraft. My opponent's got more resources than me. I need to create more builders to create more resources, to pick up more resources. You can't do that in Dawn of War. And they've made it, in a mechanics way, so painful to play that you don't know what you're doing. And a side note, there's no resignation feature. Even in the 1v1. Or surrender. I can understand there being no resignation feature for 2v2s or 3v3s. But at least make a surrender button. Your options are to rage quit the game and not get any experience points or skulls, which I think is their right in-game currency. Or sit there and wait for your opponent to slowly whittle you down and fuck you. Which, in a game where the snowball is there and you're going to lose in 6 minutes, seems weird to me. Might just be me. That's my main point. That's my main problem with the game. If you don't believe me, go onto Steam, download it. This will be going up on Sunday, so there's still Monday for you to play. See for yourself, basically. The game is, it's not enjoyable. A few other problems with it. Only 3 races. Army Painter is all fine and good, and you can make your men look as pretty as you want, but if I pick Black Templars, I'd really like to have some Sword Brethren. If I pick Blood Angels, I'd love some Death Company. If I pick Space Wolves, I'd love some Thunderwolf Cavalry. There's no uniqueness, other than the colours of your army, and that's not good enough. That's terrible. That's just dumb. There was no reason they couldn't have just... If you're going to make it 3 races, add some difference in it, right? So the Space Marines, add difference in your armies, right? Say you can make your army look like Black Templars, and you get access to Black Templar Sword Brethren. Or say you make it a successor chapter of the Black Templars, and you get access to Sword Brethren. Or Blood Angels get access to Death Company. Or all Blood Angels and their successor chapters have Death Company. Why not add that as a unit? That's just lazy. It's just bad design. Give people more things to mess with. People in RTSs love variants. Or, I know I certainly like variants, and I know all my friends like variants. So why aren't you adding it? Why is there only 3 races? And they say there will be 3 races, and there are 15 heroes on each, and that's great. But the problem is you're putting the variants in a snowball mechanic. And you only get access to 3 of those elites a game. You can't have all of them. It's 3 per game. You get to equip them and slot them in. That seems like a waste to me. It just seems like lazy design. And the same with the Orcs and the Eldar. Why not add specific units? Why not add, with the Orcs, add Speed Freaks? If you're going to play Speed Freaks, make your vehicles go faster. But then give them a consequence of something else. Or make something else, some other army, have a objective, have a bonus that is different. There was so much more room for expansion, and they didn't take it. And sure, the counter argument is, then it takes away the ability to customize your own army. And that's fine. That's fair. That is completely fair. I understand there are a lot of people who want to look at this and go, oh, I want to paint my own Space Marine. And I'll paint it in-game. And I'll make myself a color scheme. And I will run that color scheme to the end of the Earth. And that's fair enough. But if that's the case you're going for, why the hell are there only three armies? Because that just seems lazy. Soulstorm had, oh, let's have a look, a lot. The original Dawn of War had four, Winter Assault added five, Dark Crusade added Necrons and Tau, that's seven, and then Soulstorm added Dark Eldar and Sisters of Battle, so that's nine. So the original Dawn of War had nine. Dawn of War 2 had five, to my recollection. Tyranids, Orcs, Eldar, Marines, Chaos, and Imperials, so six. Why are we now at three? And they've said they're not going to make all of the races DLC, you know, microtransaction rubbish. But I don't see how they're not going to. I mean, are they you lose either way. I had this discussion with a friend of mine. He said, well, they're just going to add it into the DLC. And the problem is, yeah, you could do that. And then people get mad at you for including stuff that should have been in the base game. But then if you don't add anything, people get mad at you because your game's small and people get bored. You don't win either way. It's just lazy. Now, maybe you were under, you know, you had to release a game by the end of the year. Maybe you had to finish the game faster. I don't know. But it's disappointing and I'm very upset about it. I love Dawn of War. I love the series. But for me, Dawn of War 3, the multiplayer, certainly is a 3 out of 10. It's awful. It looks pretty, but that's it. There is no part of this game that I want to be playing. I am holding out hope for the campaign. I hold out hope that the campaign will be good and will be serviceable and I can go into this game as a single player game and I can just play the campaign. But there's no way I'm buying this on release. And there is no way I would ever recommend anybody to buy this on release because it's not worth the money. It's not worth the money you're paying because half the game is snowball rubbish. And you've got to be really good to play it. And that's fine. If you want to be really, really good and you want to play this kind of thing and you want to be really good at it and really be the very best, then go for it. But if you're a casual player, this game's not for you. The multiplayer certainly is not for you. I hold out that there will be a lot of single player stuff, campaign, maybe extra missions, maybe just AI skirmishes. But that doesn't seem interesting to me. I don't think that's worth the £40 price tag. For me, Dawn of War 3 has failed. Which is very upsetting because I was really looking forward to it, this game. It's in my list of games I was really excited for this year. Dawn of War 3, Spellforce 3. I was really excited for a bunch of games coming out this year. And I mean, I'm going to be excited for it. You know, E3's around the corner. I'm going to be excited for it. But this one has failed me and I am disappointed by it. TLDR, would not recommend this to anybody. Do not buy it for the multiplayer. Multiplayer is snowbally and not very interesting. Go back and buy Dawn of War 1 on Steam because it's probably cheaper even if you buy all the expansions and you're going to get a better time out of it. That's the end. Kind of a sad note to end on, but thank you very much for listening. If you enjoy these, show it to your friend. Talk to them. Discuss it with your friend. You got anything you want to add to what I've said or you think I'm talking out my arse? Put it in the comments. Tell me about it. Tell me why I'm talking out my arse. Though, please try and sound at least vaguely literate when you do it. There have been a lot of people who have disagreed with my opinions, but just not sure they understand the basic principle of humanity. But, yeah, whatever. We'll move on. Thank you very much for listening. Goodbye.